Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, we want to talk about complex data types, finite sets, lists, tuples, maps and functions, and records and unions. So let's get started. Recall from a previous video that a data type is a set of values, and all the values in this set have a common sense. They have a common intended meaning. Now we can also define operations on these values. A typical example operation would be value equality. Two values are only equal if they are the same, and different values are never equal. Now also a data type could be finite or infinite, and an example of a finite data type would be, for instance, the booleans, true and false. And an example of an infinite data type would be, for example, the natural numbers. Now, since we are computer scientists, it is necessary that values in a data type have a unique digital encoding, because then we can store a value in the memory of a computer, of a digital computer. So it is the case, because every value has a unique digital encoding, that a data type is enumerable. Because you could try out all possible encodings, and if it happens to be a value, then you have your value. And all the digital encodings, they can be enumerated. You can start with 1, you go to 2, to 3, to 4, and you use whatever binary format, for instance, to represent those numbers, and there you have it. Okay, so that is what a data type is. And now in a previous video, I already showed to you some examples of simple data types. Now, in this video, I want to talk about complex data types. But before I start telling you about that, let's make some assumptions, because that makes our life a bit easier. So, for simplicity, let's assume that we're living in a Platonic world. And by that I mean that all the values we consider are objective and timeless entities that do not have any relation to physical entities. So, we have these Platonic values. So, imagine for instance the number 1 or the number 2 or the number 100,000. These values do not necessarily have a relation with physical entities. They are on its own standing, timeless entities. Values also don't change over time, because they're timeless. So why do we do that? Well, then in a later video, I can then tell you a bit about implementation issues. How can you implement data types? But in this video, we will not deal with that. So we will not deal with how to encode or decode values. So this digital encoding, unique digital encoding that every value must have, we don't have to deal with that right now. Moreover, we don't have to deal right now with how to store values in memory or how the memory layout looks like. And moreover, and very importantly, we don't deal currently with the notion of sharing and modification of values. Since values are these Platonic ideal entities, we can assume that once a value is there, it won't change. It is timeless. Okay, so then this was the list of examples that I also showed you last time, of simple data types. Now, why are these called simple data types? Because they are sort of primitives. You could say these simple data types are just as given. Now, what is a complex data type? Well, a complex data type is a data type that you build out of other data types. That makes them complex. So, to understand complex data types, it is essential to understand that complex data types themselves are still data types. And so it's still a complex data type, still has a set of values, and these values all have a common meaning. And you can also, again, define operations on these data types as well. And often you do that maybe by looking at the structure of how you have created complex values. Now, to give you an example of some complex data types, let's consider the complex data type of finite sets of integers. Now here, the integers are the simple data, is a simple data type. But now we have finite sets of integers. You could imagine also to have finite sets of booleans. So that's showing you that these complex data types you can build out of arbitrary other data types. So you could even imagine that you have finite sets of themselves finite sets of integers. That is also a complex data type. Another example of a complex data type would be lists of integers. Now, what is the difference between lists and finite sets? Is that a finite set, you don't care about the ordering of the elements in the finite set, while in the list, it's also finite, the ordering in which the elements appear in a list becomes significant. Now, there are also, just like finite sets of integers, you could also imagine that you have lists of integers. Then you see that these complex data types you could build out of other data types. Now, another example of a complex data type would be tuples of, say, integers and booleans. But you could imagine that all these italic data types here you could replace by other data types. So it is also possible to have tuples of lists of integers and of finite sets of integers, for instance. And this is how you can build up your data types, your complex data types. We also have maps, but later on in the video I will explain to you what these complex data types are. So let's start with the first and quite important complex data type, namely finite sets. So let's assume that we start with a given, already given, data type. Let's call it D. Now you can form the data type of finite sets which comprise elements of your given data type D. And so then you write P fin, subscript fin of D, and that itself, then you mean by that is a data type of finite sets of elements of D. And so this P typically stands for power set, so you can imagine this to be the set of all sets of elements of D, and then the subscript fin indicates that we're interested here in the finite sets of elements of D. So to give you an example, let's make it concrete. Take the simple data type of integers and now build out of that the data type of finite sets of integers. So by pfin z, I mean the data type of finite sets of integers. And then you could ask yourself, well, is the empty set then a value of that data type? Well, it is, because the empty set, it's finite, because it consists of zero elements. And is, for instance, the set consisting of an individual integer x then a finite set of integers? Yes, that is the case, because the set is finite, it only has one element in it. And indeed, you could construct such a singleton set, as it is called, for each possible integer that exists. Okay, and here is another example of a finite set of integers. It consists of three elements. But now, as I already mentioned, finite sets, the order in which you write down the elements thereof is irrelevant. So sets are totality of elements, but it does not matter in what order the elements are in the set. So sets don't care about in what order you list the elements. If you write things down, you have to somehow write things down in order. But the concept of a set abstracts away from this ordering. Now you could also ask yourself the question, hey, is it not the case that the set of integers themselves is a finite set of integers? Well, that is not the case. So the set of integers z is not a finite set. So it cannot be in the data type of finite set of integers, finite sets of integers. Okay, if we have finite sets, then you could ask yourself, well, it's a data type. So we now understand what are the possible values. These are the finite sets. They have a common sense. They're all sets. They're all finite. And they're homogeneous. That means that the elements in the set are all of the same data type themselves. So then, could we maybe imagine operations on finite sets? Well, sure. So suppose you're given two finite sets. Let's call them S and T. And I don't care here about the particular data type that you use to build these finite sets out. So take an arbitrary D, and then for that arbitrary D, then build the data type of finite sets of it, and then take a finite set S and T. Then you could ask yourself, well, how many elements has a finite set? And this is an operation you could define. It is for every finite set known how many elements there are in. And this, the number of elements of a set is also called its cardinality. Now, you could also ask yourself, given a finite set S, could you maybe give me an element that is in that finite set? Could you choose an element that is in the set? Well, that's another operation. But then you might ask yourself, but what if the set is empty? Well, yeah, then the choice is not defined. So choice only makes sense for non-empty finite sets. You could also ask yourself, given a particular value in your data type D, is that value X an element of my finite set of D, of elements in D? And this is a test. You could test whether this value X is in your set or not. And this, if it is the case, then you call X a member of S. And if it's not, then X is not a member of S. So this is a membership test. That's also an operation that you could perform. And now you could imagine that whenever you have the operation of choice, so a non-empty finite set S, and you take some element out of it, then it must be the case that the element that you have chosen was indeed a member of the finite set that you started with. You could also ask yourself, given this finite set S and finite set T, are these two finite sets equal? And what does that mean? When are two finite sets equal? Well, you could say two finite sets are equal whenever they have the same cardinality. And for every element that is in S, that element must also be in T. And for every element in T, it must also be the case that it is in S. So S and T have the same cardinality, and moreover, they have the same members. And if that is the case, then S and T are equal. And as soon as you find an element that is in S but is not in T, then S and T are not equal. And as soon as you find an element that is in T but not in S, then the two sets are not equal. Other example operations you could imagine is taking the union. So suppose S and T are finite sets, then you can take the union. So that is another finite set which has as elements, the members of the S union T are precisely the members in S and the members in T. So you throw them together to form a new set. So to be more precise, if an element is in S, then it is also in the union S, the union of S and T. And if an element is a member of T, then it's also a member of the union S and T. And you can also define operation intersection. An element is only in the intersection whenever it's both in S and in T. You could also continue with giving operations such as removal of sets from sets, etc. Okay. Now I would like to show to you a nice property that holds. Namely, if you know that the data type you started with is finite, then the finite sets you could construct out of that data type must also be finite. And moreover, if you know that the finite sets of some data type, there are only finitely many such finite sets, then the data type itself must also be finite. And so that is phrased as D is a finite data type if and only if the data type of finite sets of D is a finite data type. So the proof goes as follows. So let's do first the one direction. So assume that D is a finite data type. And now we want to prove that then also the data type of finite sets of elements of D itself is also finite. So then you can imagine that the data type D, because it's finite, it consists of n distinct values. So now we know that. Now consider that we're given an arbitrary finite set S out of elements that that are in the data type D. Then imagine that how many such finite sets could you construct? Well, that depends on how you can see such a finite set. Well, and one way of seeing a finite set would be as follows. It is namely the case that for every element in D, so for every value in your data type D, it must be either the case that your value is in your given finite set or it isn't. And this is the case for every possible finite set that you can imagine. So then you can associate to every finite set S a unique function, it's also called a characteristic function F, which takes every element in the data type D and then assigns it to the booleans true or false, in such a way that this function f gives you a true whenever x, the argument of f, is indeed a member of s, and it gives you back a false whenever x is not a member of s. And then you can imagine how many such functions could you give. Well, since d is finite and the booleans are also finite, then you have a function between a finite set and a finite set, and there are only finitely many such functions that there are. And how many are there? Well, there are 2 to the power n such numbers. There are 2 to the power n number of such functions. Okay, so if there are finitely many characteristic functions, and each finite set is associated to precisely one such characteristic function, well, then it must also be the case that you have only finitely many finite sets over D. Okay, so that's one direction. Now, the other direction, we now want to show that if the data type of finite sets of elements of D is itself finite, then the data type D must be finite. Well, and you can show that by the contrapositive. And that means, suppose that D is not a finite data type, so suppose that D is an infinite data type, then show that the number, the data type of finite sets of D must also be infinite. Well, so we assume that D then is an infinite data type. Well, if it is an infinite data type, it means that you can generate infinitely many values in it. And you have already seen a construction of a finite set, namely the singleton set. So if for each value in the data type D you could construct a singleton finite set, and there are infinitely many values in D, well, then there must also be infinitely many finite sets of D. And that you can see by seeing that there are infinitely many singleton sets. Okay, so that's the proof. Let's continue with the next complex data type, and that is the data type of lists. So again, let's assume that D is an arbitrary given data type, and then you can consider that LD is the data type of lists that consists of elements of D. So these lists are homogeneous, meaning that all the values that or the elements of the list are of the data type D. Okay, so then can you give an example of a list? Sure, so take concretely the data type, the simple data type of the integers, Z. Well, then if you have the empty list, that you then write by these empty square brackets, if you have the empty list, well, then you have an empty list of integers. And you can also imagine that for every integer, there is the list consisting of only that integer. So then the length of that list is 1. You can also imagine that you have a list, minus 2, 5, 8. And now the order in which these integers are given is significant. So for instance, the list minus 2, 8, 5 is a different list. So although they share the same number of elements, and although it is the case that they have precisely the same elements, the elements are presented in a different order, which makes the two lists different from each other. Okay, so now given two lists S and T, of some arbitrary data type D, then what are typical operations on lists? Well, you could imagine how many elements has S. You can call that the size or the length of the list. You could also ask yourself, well, what is the ith element? So the element at position I in the list S. This is also called positional access to the elements of the list. Now, you can also ask yourself, well, are the lists S and T equal? Well, and that you can then understand, when are two lists equal? Well, two lists are equal whenever they have the same size. And moreover, for all the positions, they have the same value. And so you can check the equality of two lists by walking through both lists at the same time and checking that each time the elements in the same positions must also be the same. And if that is then the case, the elements of the list at each position is the same, well then the lists are the same. Okay, another example of an operation would be, suppose S is a list, and now we take an arbitrary value X out of our data type D. Well, then you can imagine that you put this X in front of the list S. And another example of an operation that operates on two lists is, for instance, appending two lists. So suppose you have a list S and you have a list T, then you can put the list T after the list S and then you obtain a new list. For instance, it is the case that the size of this appended list is, of course, the sum of the size of S and T. Okay, so these are example operations that you could define on lists. And there are others that you could also define. And one particular interesting operation on lists you could imagine is the following. You could produce new lists if you're given an old list and a function that operates on the values in that list. And this function is typically called mapping. So suppose you have a list of elements and you have a function. Now, what if you apply the function to every of the elements of the list? And now you construct a new list out of the old list, but you replace at every position the old value by the value that you obtain by supplying the old value to the function. And then you can construct a new list. So that is an example of an operation that works on lists. And by the way, if you ask yourself, I give you here the definition of this map function. It has two arguments. One is a higher order argument, it's this f, and the second argument is a list. So why would this be a definition? Well, it's interesting because it's defined by looking at the structure of the list. And either a list is empty or a list is non-empty. And if it's non-empty, then it must be the case that there is some value in front of some remainder list. And because you can discriminate these two cases, it is possible to give a definition. And this is also called a definition by cases. Okay, so that's lists. Let's give a concrete example of applying this map to a list. So suppose you're given a list of integers, call it S. It consists of 0, 5, 2, 7, 4, 3. These are just integers. And now suppose you're given a function that's called odd, and the function odd takes integers and gives you booleans in such a way that the odd integers go to true and the even integers go to false. Well, then you can now apply map with the arguments odd and S. And then what do you obtain? Well, we obtain a list of the same length, right? Where for each of the values that were in the original list, we now apply the function in this case odd. So suppose we apply odd to 0, well, 0 is not an odd number, so we then put false in the resulting list. 5 is an odd number, so we put true in the resulting list, and 2 is an even number, so we put false in the resulting list, etc. So for each of these elements we apply the function and then we obtain a resulting list. And that's a way to construct lists out of other lists using this higher order function. Okay, other complex data types, tuples. What are tuples? Well, tuples are basically a way of combining values out of different data types. So suppose you're given different data types, but the data types could also be the same. Suppose you're given D1, D2, D3, etc. They're different or the same data types. It's not really important. Now, you could imagine if you choose a value from D1 and you choose a value from D2 and you keep them together, well, then you form a pair of values. Well, and this pair of values is then a value of the tuple data type, of the pair data type. So to say that, D1 times D2, this is just notation for the data type of pairs. And what are pairs? Pairs are elements. In the first position, you choose one from data type D1. And the second, you choose a value out of data type D2. Now, you can also imagine, instead of pairs, that you have triples. And instead of triples, you could imagine that you have the data type of quadruples, etc., etc., etc. Now, to give you examples how to write down, for instance, the elements of these data types, you could, for instance, say, okay, I have 1 and true. 1 is a value in the data type of integers, and true is a value in the data type of booleans. So the pair of 1 and true is a value in the data type of pairs of integers and booleans. You could also create triples, so for instance, triples of booleans, time of day, and unsigned 8-bit integers. Well, and then this would be a triple in the data type of triples. And you can imagine that you can also build complex data types out of previously given data types. So then you could imagine, let's take the data type of lists of integers. And now we form the pairs of lists of integers and pairs of booleans and integers. And so this is itself a complex data type. Itself is a pair. And the first element in the tuple is a list of integers. Okay, so we can give a list of integers, say minus 5, 2. That's a list of integers. And then the second element of the pair is itself also a pair of booleans and integers. So for instance, take true 5. The pair true 5 is itself a value of the data type pairs of booleans and integers. And so since the first element and the second element both are values that you have chosen out of the respective data types, the resulting pair is then a value in the pairs of lists of integers and pairs of booleans and integers. Okay. So let's say that we have an n-tuple, and this is the generalization of pairs, triples, quadruples, etc., etc., etc. So the size of the number of elements of a tuple, you can say it's an n-tuple, then a pair is a 2-tuple, and a triple is a 3-tuple, and a quadruple is a 4-tuple, etc. So given an n-tuple A and B, now you could ask yourself, well, can you give some operations on this complex data type? Well, sure. You could ask yourself, what is the ith element of A? And that allows you to project, as it is called, the tuple to one of its particular individual constituents. Or you could ask yourself, if I am given two n-tuples that are constructed out of the same data type, when are these tuples equal? Well, tuples are equal precisely when all the I elements coincide. So suppose A and B are pairs, of say integers and integers, then A and B are equal when the first element of the A and the first element of B are the same integer, and the second element of A and the second element of B are the same integer. And this projection, an example of a projection could be, for instance, I define a function first, and then it takes a tuple, AB, and then the function first gives you back the first element in the tuple. And you have the second function, maybe a second takes a tuple, that is a pair. And suppose the pair consists of an A and a B, then the second element, of course, is the same as the second element in the pair. And the same thing you could do for triples, etc. Okay, so those are tuples. So let's continue then with maps. So maps, you could understand as associating so-called keys to values. Okay, so suppose we're given a data type of keys, and suppose we're given a data type of values then. Then you can form the data type of maps from the data type of keys to the data type of values. And you use this sort of a harpoon symbol to indicate, to give some kind of way of writing down that you're talking about maps. Maps from the data type of the keys to the data type of the values. So an example would be, for instance, if you take the simple data types of integers and the simple data type of booleans, that you then consider the data type of integers, the data type of maps from integers to booleans. So this is the data type of maps from integers to booleans. And then you could ask yourself, okay, how do I write down then the individual elements? Well, the maps are interesting because they allow you to associate a value from the data type, from the key data type, to a value from the value data type. So in this case, I here see a zero and then a maps to symbol. I have a zero that is mapped to true. So the value zero is mapped to true by this map. And the value one as a key is mapped to the value false in this map. But it is not necessary for maps to associate every key. So you also have empty maps, for instance. Maps that do not associate any key to some value. You could also imagine a map in which you use the booleans as keys, and then you map the booleans to integers. So you swap, for instance, the keys and values, and you get different kinds of maps. And this is an example map. It maps true to the integer 50, and it maps false to the integer 49. But this is a map, this is an example map, that for every value, true and false, it associates a value. So these maps are special because you call them total maps. Okay, and now it depends, of course, on the programming language, how you would construct maps. Some programming languages allow you to construct maps in very complicated manners, and others only allow you to construct simple maps by giving, in an imperative style, maybe a way to construct these values. Okay, so to give you an example of typical operations on maps, consider two maps, F and G, and you can often think, often confuse maps and functions. That's typically done, but we will come back to the difference between maps and functions later. But I use the symbol F and G to indicate the maps here between the DK, the data type of keys, and the data type of values. Now, a typical operation would be, given the map F and an arbitrary key X that is in the data type of keys, you can ask yourself, well, does this map F actually have an associated value for the given key? This is also called definedness. Does the map F define a value for a given key? In another, you could also ask yourself another question. As soon as a map has a defined value for a key, well, what is it? So given a map and a key, and you know that the key is associated to some value by the map f, well, what value then? And this is an operation that you typically call lookup. Okay, and then you can ask yourself, well, when are two maps, say f and g, equal? And that question you could also answer as follows. Well, f and g are equal whenever they have precisely defined the same keys, and for each key, f and g map to the same value. And then you can consider f and g to be the same maps. You could also imagine an operation given a map f that then performs an update on the map. This gives you potentially a new map back. So you take a map, say f, and now you want to replace for key x its association to value v. Well, there are two possibilities. Either f did not define x yet, well, then the update will define x, namely by associating it to value v. Or f already has defined x, well, then the update will remove the previous association, so to say, and now associates x to v. And then it gives you a new map, potentially a new map. Okay, maybe an interesting thing to consider is that these maps that associate keys to values can be seen as special kinds of finite sets. Okay, and how? How could you do that? Well, let's consider the data type of finite sets of pairs of keys and values. And now these finite sets, it allows you to see the finite sets consists of pairs, and the first element in the pair is a key, and the second element in each pair is a value. Well, and not every such finite set can be considered a map. No, we have a special restriction. This restriction is called functionality, namely that as soon as you have two pairs that both have the same key x in S, then it must also be the case that the value associated to S, the value associated to X must also be the same. So that means you cannot have in your finite set of key value pairs for the same key different values. Now, in a map, if there is a pair for some key X, then it is associated to at most one value, meaning only one pair can be in your finite set with the key x, and that associates then the value. You cannot have an x and a y, and an x and a y prime, and that y and y prime are then different. That is not allowed. Okay, and in that way you could consider maps as special finite sets. Well, if you know that, then it becomes clear that maps at most associate one value to a key. Either the key is not defined by the map, or if it is defined, then at most one value is associated to the key. And now you can also understand total map as being a map for which every key has an assigned value. Okay, now you could ask yourself, what is the difference between maps and functions? Okay, let's consider it by seeing the following claim. There are more functions from natural numbers to Booleans than there are total maps from natural numbers to Booleans. Oh, okay, why? Why is that the case? So let's see the proof maybe. So the first thing is to consider is that if you have a total map from natural numbers to Booleans, you could see it as a function. Because you know the map is total, every key must have an associated value. Well, you could define a function in that way, that the function's result is precisely the lookup in your map. And so you could treat every total map as a function that way. But is the opposite also the case? Can you treat every function also as a total map? Well, suppose that this is the case. Suppose that every function from natural numbers to booleans, for every such function there also exists a total map which maps for precisely the same inputs to the function. The map has an association to a value, a boolean, and that boolean is precisely the output of the function for that input. Well, if this then is assumed, well, we know maps are data types. And data types must be enumerable because every value of a data type has a unique digital encoding. And we could imagine just trying out all possible digital encodings. You could enumerate that. And then you eventually find out every possible value. So every map it has a digital encoding, and therefore all the possible maps there are can be enumerated. You can create an infinite list in which you just give every possible value there is in the data type of total maps. Okay, so now suppose we do that. Suppose that we now create such an enumeration. So here you see a table. And the table can be read as follows. So this is the first total map. And how do you read it? Well, this first total map assigns to the natural number 0 the Boolean false. And the first total map that you enumerate assigns to the natural number 1 the value false. And so this is the key and this is the value. And since it's a total map, you can imagine that it does this for every natural number there must be a Boolean. Right, so you could imagine that this first total map is just assigning the value false to every possible natural number. Okay, and since maps are data types and data types are enumerable, it is possible to enumerate all these total maps. So look at the second total map and look at the third total map. So the third total map, again, it is a map because it assigns the key 0 to the value true, and it assigns the key 1 to the value false and the key 2 to the value false, etc., etc., etc. Okay, so now we have an enumeration. The enumeration goes this way of all possible total maps. Okay, and if this is then the case, well then, consider now the resulting diagonal in the table. You could imagine that the first total map you have enumerated has a particular value that it associates to the key 0. And the second map that you have enumerated associates a particular value to the key 1. And the third associates a particular value to the key 2, etc. So the ones in red is called the diagonal of this table. Now, this diagonal, it represents these values. Now, you could imagine there exists a function from naturals to booleans. And how do you define that function? Well, that function is defined as follows. The value, if the argument is 0, then the value is the flipped one at this position. So the function assigns 0 to true, and it assigns 1 to false, and it assigns 2 to true, and it assigns 3 to false, and it assigns 4 to true, etc., etc. Now, it does not matter at all how you have enumerated all these total maps. It's always possible to construct such a diagonal, at least conceive of such a diagonal function. And now it is the following case. Because this function, it must exist, because I have just defined it to you, it's uniquely defined in this manner. There's no confusion about what function I'm talking about here. But this function cannot be equal to any of the enumerated total maps here. Why? Well, the function is not equal to the first because it differs in this value, because we flipped it. And it cannot be equal to the second because it differs on this value, because we flipped it. And it cannot be equal to the third total map because it's different on this value, because we flipped it, etc. So this is a particular function that cannot be part of the enumeration. But we now have a function that is not part of this enumeration, but we assumed that there are as many functions as total maps. So for each function, there must be a total map. And then since we know that maps are data types, these total maps are enumerable. So it must be the case that it is enumerable. But we just established that it is not enumerated. Well, that's a contradiction. Eh? So since this is a contradiction, it is not the case that there are as many functions as there are total maps. Eh? But since we know that every total map can also be considered a function, it then must be the case that there are more functions than there are total maps. Okay, and this argument, this proof, you can also, it's a well-known proof. It's called Cantor's diagonalization argument. And you can follow this link to read more about this proof. Okay, so there are more functions than there are total maps. Interesting. What do we have else for complex data types? Well, we have records. And records you can see is sort of fancy tuples. And so instead of having tuples in which we have the position at which values are known, you could form pairs or triples, quadruples, etc. Records then give a name to each of these positions. So suppose you're given a finite set of names. Well, then a record is a particular structure that for each of the name has an associated data type. So then a record, the value in this data type, a record, a particular record, is then an assignment of every name to a value in each of the data types associated to that name. Okay. Records are also known as or called named tuples or structures. And in a previous video, you have already seen a structure, for instance, in the C programming language. Okay. The number of names of a record type, you could imagine that is just the size of the tuple. Eh? And now, just like you had projections for tuples, allowing you to get the first, the second, the third, etc. element of the tuple, you can now imagine that for records, we can use the name to project the record down to its individual value for each of its constituents. And this is also typically called field access, field access of a particular record. So then the names are also called fields, and then a record assigns to every field a value in the data type associated to such a field. Okay, so an example would be, for instance, the 3D coordinates, let's say in the data type of integers. So that means we have a record with the fields x, y, and z. Well, then you could write down, maybe you could write it down in that order. So 50 then is the value of x, and 0 is then the value of y, and z is then the value of, 25 is then the value of z. Or you could write it down as a map, where you then use the names of the record as keys. This all depends on the programming language in question, what kind of notation is used to construct records. And now you can use the field access, so that is, for instance, the following expression. If you have a particular record which assigns 50 to x and 0 to y and 25 to z, and you want to then project it down to the field x, well, then you just look up what is the value assigned to the field x. Well, that is in this case 50. Or if you use the different notation, you could ask yourself, if this is a record which assigns to the field x the value 50, and the field y the value 0, the field z the value 25. And if you now want to know, well, what is then now my the value of the field x, that's 50. So what is then the distinction, you could ask yourself, between maps and records? Well, records allow you to use different data types for different fields. And in maps, you have the data type of keys and the data type of values, and those are fixed. But in records, you're allowed to have, for instance, you could have a record of an employee. That's a typical example in programming. Then its name could be a list of characters, a string, or It could have a salary, which is then some kind of integer value representing the amount of euros that the employee receives on his or her bank account every month. These are different data types, but you can put them together in a record and associate names to the fields. And each name has different, potentially different data type. Okay, so that is records. There are also complex data types of unions. Suppose you're given the data type D1 and D2. These are different already given data types. Then a union you could think of as throwing all the values of D1 and all the values of D2 on one big pile. And if you do that, then the resulting data type consists precisely of those values that are either in the data type D1 or in the data type D2. And if you do it like this, then you call the data type a free union. Now, an example of that, for instance, concretely take the integers and the booleans. It is the case that then the value true is a value of the free union of the integers and the booleans. Because true is a boolean, so then it is also a value of the free union. And 1 is an integer, so 1 must also be a value of the free union of integers and booleans. Okay. And so minus 1 is another example. But then what if you now, you could also nest it. So you could create lists of free unions of integers and booleans. And this allows you to create heterogeneous lists. So in which lists, in which different kinds of values from different data types can appear. So this is a list of integers or booleans. You could also read it like that. So it could be that the values of integers or the values of the booleans are listed in this way. But you could imagine that some confusion could arise. Because for instance, 15 is both an integer. So it is in the data type of the integers, but it is also an unsigned integer that can be represented by 8-bit. So these are different data types, but they have the same values in their set of values. So then which one do you have then? Do you now have the integer or do you have the unsigned 8-bit integer? Which one do you have? Well, that you then don't know in this case. So then some confusion may arise. Is this now a value in the integers, or is this a value in the unsigned 8-bit integers? Well, you don't know because you threw it all on one big pile. You can now no longer know from the value in the free union whether that value came from one or the other. So then some confusion may arise. Well, and then there is also a different construction, a different complex data type, and this is called the discriminated union. And the discriminated union does the same thing as unions in the sense of that you can pick a value from D1 and then it is also a value of the discriminated union. Or you can pick a value from D2 and then it is also a value of the discriminated union. But moreover, you keep track of which data type you have pulled your value out of. So to give you an example, again with the concrete simple data type of integers and booleans, you can now write that as saying, okay, I have the left one, so I use this floor operation. I have the left one, so the value true is in the booleans, so I take the left data type, and now I have a value of the discriminated union, or I take the right. So minus five is an integer, so then an integer which is then using these ceiling brackets, then is a value of my discriminated union. And now, no longer any confusion can occur, because if I have 15, then of course it depends on whether I have pulled 15 out of the left or out of the right. So in this case, it is clear that I have the 15 on the left, so this must be the 15 from the integer. But if I have now the 15 out of the right, well, then this was obviously a 15 from the unsigned integers that can be represented by 8-bit. And so no longer any confusion can arise where you got your value from in the discriminated union data type. Okay, this is the end of this video. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you soon again.